Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our new piano and our location in the Clemente. And tonight we have Mara Rosenbloom on this beautiful piano and Sean Conley on his beautiful bass and Melanie Dyer on viola. Enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Awesome. Welcome back after that amazing performance. I really enjoyed it. And honestly, before we get into it, I wanted to ask, because I know you said the ensemble had a name. Could you say it one more time?
Bone Labyrinth.
Bone Labyrinth.
Yeah.
Like a maze.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's different. A labyrinth is different than a maze, but that kind of thing, yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, a labyrinth is what's different. So, like, a maze, you have many paths you could choose. You can... but with a labyrinth, it's a unicursal path. It's a single... It's a single route.
Uh-huh.
So it's windy. You might not think you're getting to the end, but it's just one meditative path.
Wow.
Yeah.
And may I ask, is there any reason that you chose bone?
Yeah, well, I got to say that Bone Labyrinth is this, we've been throwing this labyrinth idea, me and Melanie, around for a little while. So it's something we've been talking about. Your inner ear has a bone labyrinth.
Mm.
There's a part of your inner ear that's, yeah.
Wow.
It's labyrinthian.
Yeah, no, I think it's a technical term. The exterior, the interior. I'm always trying to bridge the gap, I guess.
Definitely. And that's interesting. How often do you perform with this specific trio, at all?
I guess this is the first time. Yeah.
Cool. Yeah.
I mean, me and Sean have played together for a long time, and me and Melanie more recently for a good amount of time. Mm-hmm. But yeah, this is the first time as a trio.
Wow.
Yeah.
And may I ask each of you what you find about this specific trio that comes out to you? The experience playing in it, I'm sure, is different in this music because everybody has their own, they're speaking their own part. So what do you feel about this ensemble? What is unique about it to you?
The first thing I would say is that I love the fact that it's viola and bass.
Mm-hmm.
They're kind of my two favorite strings.
Wow.
I mean, I love the violin and the cello, but they're actually, to me, those two instruments have this sense of, like, something about the violin and the cello, as beautiful as they are, they're almost too beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have this human-like seed in the middle where you can meet someone who's incredibly beautiful and ugly at the same time. Mm. And I feel like our instruments have this wide range of expression, mm-hmm. you know, that has this earthy human quality that's not about being perfect.
Wow,
you know?
Yeah.
Mm. And I think it mixes really well,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Definitely.
Yeah. That's really interesting, Sean. I mean, first the term ugly beauty, you know, taken from Monk. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, at least in Western European repertoire, the bass and the viola have a pretty long history together.
That's right.
Yeah.
And we're the overlooked ones often, you know, too. So it's interesting, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. No, I just enjoy playing Mara's music, and I've really enjoyed playing with you, Sean. I feel like we had an immediate kind of connection.
Yeah.
Mara's music has an openness, and that allows you to move through it in different ways. And I think one of the things that struck me immediately when we came together is our ability to listen and dialogue with one another. I thought that was pretty amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I could echo all that. Just I think we had Melanie and I had a quick sort of intuitive connection just as improvisers together. Sean and I have barely gotten a chance to play over the course of the pandemic, but before that we played together for many years, so I mean, for me, it is really a joy to return. I feel just like stepping back into the water, and it's like really, I mean, I feel we really know each other's rhythms, and so.
I always find it interesting too when like we're playing for the this is our first gig together, and what we do as musicians and improvisers is so intimate that sometimes you meet new people, you're not really sure you want to show, you know, that much of your inner soul.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then you put a few notes out with some people, and you're like, oh, okay, like they're hearing me, you know, and it's just interesting to like figure out the psychological ramifications of being that, I guess, open,
right,
to
right.
some new people, you know? I always find that really fascinating.
Definitely. Now, I noticed that you guys had some music on some stands, and I was curious, since you composed it,
yeah.
what to you the connection between, you know, composed, in, you know, pre-composed, and then improvisation, and then how do you make the two come together in a way that seems fluid?
Yeah. Well, the first thing that I was thinking about, kind of tacking onto what you're saying about just when new people get together and like how much of yourself do you want to show, this time I was thinking, we haven't done this as a trio, like navigated how much of the composed thing are we gonna try to do and how much of it are we gonna try to let go. And that, I think, is always like a new process, bringing different people together to sort of like navigate what that is gonna be and to have, you know, because different people step forward at different times with elements of the written thing. And so sort of sussing that out amongst each other is, I think, like a sort of a longer process. Mm. And I mean, I'm like always just, I mean, I hear things that are true for me that I feel compelled to write down. So I continue to write.
Mm-hmm.
But then I hope that it's just sort of like an offering of my story first, I guess, to an ensemble, and to just kind of open some doors and set some things going.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I mean, we have to give over to the moment. And I feel like a different relationship to it, I think, after the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
I feel sort of like less tethered to what I wrote. And
could you expand on that? As in how, do you know, maybe the causality of what you're talking about?
Yeah, well, I think it's been just a period of thinking about what really matters.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been so much time away from like most human connection,
mm-hmm.
and so much time away from the music. And so like when we're in the moment, you know, like having this time now, I feel like I wrote stuff. I had thoughts about what we were gonna play today, but I also felt like, you know, like let's just be here together because it's valuable enough.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't know. I think it will continue to change. I think my relationship to composing and free is it's shifting a little.
Definitely. Now, I couldn't help but notice, you know, most people who come through Arts for Art, I feel like have a, I'll say, more traditional instrumentation, whereas this was closer to something that someone might assume would come from, like, a classical standpoint. And of course, you know, boxes and stuff like that, music is music. But that being, I feel like that being kind of unique in the scene, is there something, you know, do you operate differently with you know, different people coming from different backgrounds when you're preparing the ensemble, or are you just thinking like, you know, I give people notes and then however their instrument interprets it is just kind of what it is? Does that make sense?
Are you talking about writing for different instruments or writing for different people just coming from different genres, like different styles of music that you're used to playing?
Yeah, I guess instrumentation, maybe I didn't phrase it too well. Yes, I guess instrumentation, because, you know, I guess I should say, you know, in the free jazz world, there's a history of strings, instruments, and stuff like that, and things that come from the orchestra world, like the French horn even, and so on and so forth. But so when thinking about maybe even this ensemble, what is, I mean, well, maybe I'll...
Well, I think Sean and Melanie could answer this too. I mean, they're both
definitely
composers who write a variety of interesting music, but yeah, I mean, I really think about the person. I really think about the individual person and their voice. when I'm writing, or when I'm just inviting people to get together and I'm not writing anything. That's really what I'm thinking about. And I mean, just, I mean, in terms of instruments, I mean, I think about range, you know, just on a very basic level. You know, I certainly consider that if I'm writing a melody, I know a particular, like a certain singer is going to sing it, or a viola is going to play it, a trombone is going to play it. I might think about where it lays, but I think in this music, mainly I'm thinking about personalities and like personal sounds.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely. Would you like to say anything?
I was going to say, I find that I play differently with different people and with different instruments. You know, like if I'm playing with two tenor saxophones, a drummer and a bass player, I might, my voice may, you know, change a little bit, you know, or, you know. So I think that, you know, just the vibe is different in different ensembles, no matter what the music, no matter what the music is. And I agree also, you know, I write with certain people in mind. But I also end up writing things and saying, oh, you know, this might be great for so-and-so, you know? So sometimes the music always comes before anything else, you know, like, it just happens. Mm. But then, you know, if you live with it for a while and you say, oh, well, maybe we should try this with these folks or, you know, so anyway, that's the way it rolls out for me sometimes.
Definitely. Go ahead, please.
Well, you know, I just think it's interesting because even if you were to say, oh, I'm writing for viola with no person in mind, every person who comes in, it's going to sound different. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in the end, if you don't embrace the actual individual, you're really missing, I think, what is the beauty of the experience. You know?
Definitely. And would you say that you two as composers have experienced a shift in your thinking about composition because of the pandemic?
No, I haven't.
You know, I think it's just more time, right? In a way, you know?
Well, I don't write a whole lot of music, so when I do, it takes a really long time to get it out, and, you know, so. But it's always kind of the same process. Mm-hmm.
I did find myself doing a lot of music that probably won't make it out from the pandemic, mm-hmm. but it kept me busy and it kept my mind in a good place.
Right.
And it gave me time to explore some other things that maybe really aren't me, but like, yep, were fun to do and mm-hmm. kept me focused, you know?
Definitely, definitely. Well, it's definitely been a cool honor having you guys on.
Thanks.
Seeing you perform, you know, I really enjoyed every bit of it. So thank you for joining us tonight. We had Mara Rosenbloom, Sean Conley, and Melanie Dyer. And we'll see you next time.
Thanks, Eric.
Definitely.